Presented by Manuel Gomez Rodriguez. He started his studies in Madrid, then continued with a master and PhD in Stanford, and then went to the Max Planck Institute for Intelligent Systems, where he is now a faculty member. And I'm very much looking forward to your talk, Manuel.
Thanks. Can you hear me?
Excellent.
Okay. Okay. Thanks a lot to the organizers for inviting me to talk here. I'm super excited about it. The presenter said, I'm Manuel. I'm actually a faculty in Max Planck for Software Systems, but I did my PhD in the Max Planck for Intelligent Systems. But anyway, it's within the Max Planck Society. And the work I would like to tell you a little bit about is, let's say, a line of research where we have several papers already, and it's a line of research that is somehow emerging. So I'm quite excited to convince you that it's something that you should get into. And this work is the result of the work of several students, postdocs, and also research collaborators, both within Max Planck and also from outside Max Planck. So what is the motivation for what we call a learning under triage? No? So a bit of motivation is that you have seen, even in the previous talks, that there is many domains where machine learning has taught actually machines to solve tasks where intelligence is required. No, you can think of taking you a phone, and you can actually search for specific images by just saying, "Oh, show me photos of, let's say, rock climbing or mountains." You can go to Google or any other service, and you can translate text automatically using machine learning. No, and as maybe you have seen in the news already, like a couple of years ago, there are machine learning algorithms that can beat like professional players of some games and play better than them. And this is something that already happened with chess, let's say many years ago, that the best chess machine players were better than humans. So you could say, well, if machine learning is so good at all these tasks, maybe you should just kind of let machine learning to just do everything, like to automate things. But here is some result, no, that was actually presented by some researchers in Cornell University, no, that they took a medical data set that in this case were just like images of the iris of people. And for these images of, let's say, the eye of people, they have some annotations made by different doctors. And for each image, you have several annotations by several different doctors, estimating the severity of a disease that in this case is called diabetic retinopathy. Okay, and a bit idea, no, is that they also have ground truth. They also know eventually whether the person had this disease, the people of corresponding to all these images. So what they did here is that they tried to say, oh, we are going to train the latest neural network to try to actually predict the severity of these images. And since they have at the same time like several doctors trying to classify or, let's say, to predict the severity of each image, you can also estimate kind of the error per image for these human doctors. So what they did at the end is they tried to say, oh, we can compute actually the error per instance, let's say per patient, for the machine and for the humans. No? And turns out that when they did that, despite the average error of the neural network was higher, actually the individual error for individual images, in some of these images, the doctors were more accurate. No? So this is basically what motivate this question of saying, well, if it turns out that the machines are better for some instances, for some images, and the humans are better for other instances, maybe it makes sense to try to actually combine them together, not to say, oh, we should combine both the intelligence of human doctors and the intelligence of machines. No? And to make it a bit more concrete, I would like to tell you a little bit more about this particular way in which we could combine this intelligence. Okay? So here is some illustration that may actually clarify a bit what I mean by combined forces. So imagine now that you have some machine that can take photos of your eye. Okay? And these machines, you can actually deploy them around a country. but maybe you have some shortage of doctors. So it's not that you may take many images of people, some of them healthy, but you don't have enough doctors to actually look at all those images. So mathematically, what you could think is, oh, these images, they will be in some kind of a feature distribution, in some kind of feature space, okay? And distributed according to a feature distribution in this space. So what you can think here is like each of these points in this kind of visualization would be basically like one image, like, let's say, one patient, no? And depending on the type of patient, the type of image would lie somewhere in this space. And here the idea would be, what we would like to do is to divide these images, this feature space, into some part that I would let the doctors to look into it, and some other part of the feature space where I will tell the machine to classify it automatically. And here the intuition behind it would be there may be many images that are just of healthy people, and they may be actually not very difficult to classify for a machine. And in most cases, this will not be a big deal because most of these people will be healthy. But when you have images that are a bit more complicated, you may like to actually have doctors to look into it. But here in learning and algorithmic triage, a bit the question is, can we do this automatically? In the sense that can we decide which of the images we are going to be sending to a doctor or classifying by the machine? But at the same time, we have to actually learn the machine. Okay, we have to train the machine learning model. So to give you a bit of an intuition, no? Because maybe when you hear about this, you may be thinking, oh, but I already know about this topic, and it's called learning to defer, no? And there is quite a lot of papers that they claim, oh, the machine learning model, once you have a deep neural network, is important to quantify uncertainty. And if they would say, oh, if the machine is very uncertain, then you should just redirect to a doctor in this domain, for example. No? But here is a one key difference that is better to illustrate with some example. Okay? So imagine to start now that you have a simple, in this case, a regression task. The prediction is like is a regression. And imagine there is only one single feature, okay, that is the x-axis, this feature x. And what you try to predict is this severity level, that is what I visualize in the y-axis. Okay? And to make things even more concrete, we say, oh, the machine models that we have, the machine learning models we have, just for making it easier to understand, they are just linear functions. Okay? Your machine is just a linear function. Okay? And what we have there is that some of these samples that you see the little balls in the visualization, you can defer them to humans. And here we say as instructed or dictated by a triage policy. The triage policy would be the one telling, oh, this point I assign it to a human, or this point I let my linear function, my machine model, to classify it. Okay? And finally, what we visualize there in the figure, this kind of band that is in blue, is just saying, oh, that is kind of the error of the humans in average for each of these points. Okay, that again, to make things easier, is just kind of a band that seems kind of constant, the error. Okay, but could be different errors depending on the instances. So learning to defer, that is what I explained before. What we do is to say, oh, I take all my data set of, let's say, pairs of features and severity levels, and I fit the best linear model that I can. For example, trying to minimize the error in the prediction. Okay? And that is what you would have there, like the line that is in red. And here is the point. Now they say, well, now to decide whether I would use my machine model or whether I would assign a point to a human, what I would do is compare the errors of my machine model in my training set and the human error in the training set. And that what would tell you is to say, well, it turns out like the points where the machine model is pretty accurate, I let the machine model to classify them, to predict the severity. That is the points that you see in red. Okay? And the points where the machine is kind of far off, I would say, well, that I leave them to the humans. But here is one key thing. This machine model, when you train it, this linear function didn't know that they could actually give up on some of these points, didn't know that some of the points you can defer to a human. So in learning under triage, the point is to realize about this fact. And a bit idea would be to say, well, maybe you would be better off to actually, if you could jointly decide about the triage policy, meaning which points you assign to a human and which points you assign to a machine, maybe this is the optimal solution, no? What I'm visualizing there, that is, you let the machine model to actually predict things that are in this kind of linear trend, and you just redirect to the humans the things that are like in the saturated regions. But in a way, this wouldn't be like completely apparent if you first train the best machine model you can for the entire, let's say, feature distribution, for the entire feature space. Okay. So a bit idea here is like we would like to jointly actually find out the best machine model for the best triage policy. Okay. But here is the point that makes things slightly complicated, no? That you give me, for example, a triage policy like the one you have on the left, and it's, oh, this is the optimal machine model, just the linear function that is just what you see visualize. But if it turns out like you take the triage policy on the center, meaning you redirect to the machines the point at the top, then the optimal machine model is a different one. It's like, oh, you would just would like to have this kind of horizontal line. Okay. On the right-hand side, you see another example, no? If you would say, oh, everything that has like positive features, I'm gonna redirect it to a machine and to my linear model. The rest I give it to humans. So if you do that, again, the optimal machine model would be a different one in terms of error. Okay. So in a way, it's like for every triage policy, every way in which you would assign points to humans and machines, you would have an optimal machine model. But the difficult thing is that, for every triage policy, like this triage policy is something you would like to also optimize. Okay, so this is what makes kind of the problem difficult and at the same time different to this paradigm of just doing uncertainty quantification in deep learning models and decide based on the uncertainty whether you defer to a human or you don't. Okay. So to kind of get started, okay, how we started kind of addressing this problem, no, was to say, okay, we are going to look at the simple case that we can. That in this case was a rich regression model that I will explain you a little bit what is that for those of you that are not familiar with it, but I guess many of you would know already that, okay? So how do we start with that, no? So let's see how do we actually formalize the problem for rich regression, okay? So what you see on the screen, I'm not sure I can use some kind of pointer. Oh, oopsie, that was a PowerPoint just crashing. Okay, let me try to again start PowerPoint. Sorry about that. Okay. Can somebody tell me whether you can see the screen?
Yes.
Okay, then let me come back to the slide. And I guess now you see it in presentation mode. Is that right?
Very good, yes.
Okay, so I'm not sure you see my pointer of the mouse pointer. Can you see it?
No.
No? Well, anyway, it doesn't matter. Then I just say like, okay, oh, let me see it here. There is a, okay, this. Okay, and can you see now what I'm just visualizing?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah,
okay, that is great. Okay, so what you see there, no, on the right-hand side, would be basically what would be the objective function in a rich regression task. That what you want to do is simply to say, you want a linear model that minimizes the quadratic error, and you have some kind of regularization on the parameters of the linear model. And the parameters of the linear model would be this W, okay? So what you want to try to do is to predict the severity, that is this YJs, based on the features that would be the XJs with these parameters W, okay? But So in a rich regression task, you just take all your points and just try to fit such a W. Okay, would be the machine model. But in this case now you have something a bit different, no? That what you could do is to say, well, there will be some samples, that is this set SC, that you can assign to the machine. And there will be some other samples, that is this S, that you can assign to humans. Okay? If you assign a sample to a human, it's not anymore this quadratic error plus the regularizer, but it's rather that you have like a human error per sample. And this is something that you would have in your data set, okay? That for each point, each sample, you have different annotations by different humans, and you can compute a quadratic error in this case. Okay? So a bit idea here is that you would like to find both the machine model, that is this W, and the sets S and S complementary. Okay? And if you just take the union of S and S complementary, you would recover the training set, all the points in the training set. So basically, some points will be in S, some points would be in the complementary. And at the same time, what you have here is that we have some constraint, no? That is like, given that maybe you have a shortage of doctors, you cannot assign as many samples as you would like to a doctor. So you have a limit in the number of samples you can assign to a human. So in a way, what would be simple an optimization problem initially in rich regression that would be finding W, in this case, you add like another variable that is somehow a set. Okay, that you would like to find the set of the training set that you would actually assign to humans and the set that you would assign to machines. So afterwards, no, you could say, and during test, what do? I have my rich regression model that initially was just W, but then it's like if I want to actually decide during test, what do I do with a sample? Do I give it to W or do I give it to the humans, because you have a set S, but that set S is in the training set, it's not during test. So what one could imagine to do during test is to say, well, you just compute, no, for the sample that is the closest in the training set to the point you are dealing during test, you see whether it was a sample that you assigned to humans or a sample you assigned to machines. And then you decide in the same way, no? So here, what is visualized on the right, what you see here, like this point would be you are pointing the test set, the thing with the kind of bold border. And because it's closer to points in blue, then you would say, oh, I assign it to a human. If it is closer to points in red, like this other sample on the bottom, you would assign it to machines. But here is now the point, no? First, we have to be able to solve during training the optimization problem on top. And that is what I would like to tell you a little bit about it and some insights about it. So here is one observation. No? If you give me a set S, like you give me, oh, this is the set I would like to actually give to machines, and this set I would like to give to humans, then you can find the optimal machine model. No? And basically, a bit the idea would be to say, oh, what you would do is just to take just the features of the points in the complementary of S, that is the set that you assign to machines, and turns out rich regression can be computed analytically, the solution. So a bit the idea is to say, oh, you just take the rows of the feature of the matrix of features, you just take the rows and the labels, the Y's of the corresponding points on the S complementary. So in a way, you give me a set, I can find the machine model for rich regression that is optimal for that set. Okay. So if you plug back that optimal solution to the original problem, turns out that in the end, you can convert the problem just to a set maximization problem. You only need to find the set S. Because the W star, the optimal machine model, you just plug it back. Okay? And here is not important like the mathematical expression, but if you notice, we have a minimization of a quadratic error, and now I convert it into a maximization because I change the sign, I put this minus sign, and at the same time, I apply logarithm that doesn't change anything. Okay? But that we will see why we do that. So in a way, now our problem is to say, can we solve this combinatorial problem, that is finding the set within the training set that maximize this objective, where we already have the optimal machine model there. Okay. So here is a bit the bad news, no? So the bad news is the following, that finding this set is an NP-hard problem. Okay, it's a problem that is that you cannot solve in polynomial time. Okay, and a bit of intuition of, oh, how do we know that it's a NP-hard problem? Somehow we didn't come up entirely with it, but we realized of the following, no? That there is some particular case of our problem that can be seen as something called robust least square, okay? And a bit the idea is like, if you would say there is no human error, okay, the humans are perfect, okay? And you have a budget on the humans, somehow you would like to decide which points you would like to defer to humans, knowing that the humans are perfect, okay? It's a particular case. So it turns out this is more or less trying to detect somehow some relates to some kind of outlier detection, okay? And in that literature, turns out that the problem has been shown to be NP-hard. So if it turns out there is a particular case of our problem that has been shown to NP-hard, our problem is NP-hard, okay? So once we cannot aim to actually solve the problem, what we can try to aim is, can we have an approximate algorithm, like an algorithm that has approximation guarantees, no? And here is an idea, no? That is to say, oh, what we could do is to just say, first, you proceed in a kind of iterative manner, in a greedy manner. So what you would do is to say, first, you just train a machine that learns to predict all points in your training set. And then you just try, oh, for if I could actually assign one point to humans, which point would it be? No, and then that problem, you can just try all possible combination of single points. No, and what you would do is you train machines for all the data set except one point, and you do that for all points. And then you just decide greedily to say whatever gives you the highest gain, you just go for that. And you would say, okay, this point is assigned to the humans, the rest to the machines. And then you proceed again to say, if I could actually assign a second point to the humans, which points could it be? And then you again try all possible options, and you proceed in that way iteratively. So this is kind of a greedy algorithm, no? So if you would do that, can we say that wouldn't be that bad, no? And turns out we can. And here is not that I have to give you like all the details, but basically the idea is that this kind of marginal gain that you are obtaining at each step of this algorithm of saying every time that you add a new point k and so on, that has a property, okay? And a bit the property is something that is an approximate notion of submodularity, that is something quite popular in the machine learning literature, okay? And what that means, that is not something that now you should follow here, but what means is that we can say that if we apply this greedy algorithm that goes iteratively, the set S that you would find in this way, after you finish the budget, let's say, you can say that is, let's say, a fraction, is greater than a fraction of the optimal. Okay? If it turns out the optimal set would give you a value of this function, of the objective function, then you can guarantee, oh, it's some kind of fraction of the optimal, and this fraction we can actually bound it. We know, oh, this alpha that shows up here is something that we can bound. Okay. So in a way, what we are saying is, oh, if you have a greedy algorithm, it's going to do well. Okay. And a bit to kind of give you a bit intuition of what happened when you apply this greedy algorithm in some particular case. Now here, I show you an example that gives the intuition. We will see later in the talk some more examples with real data. No? And this is also with real data, but let's say here the human error we try with different human errors that we synthetically generated to try to understand the algorithm. And here it's a bit intuition, no? It's in this example, what we change is that here what you see this row is basically telling you which percentage of humans, let's say which percentage of the points in the data sets the humans are very good at classifying. So if you have the 0.2, means, oh, the humans are very good at classifying 20% of the points, but not the rest. Okay. So what you see here is in the x-axis is the budget, like how many points you assign to humans. And what you could see here, no, is that as you assign more and more points to humans, the error keeps decreasing, but at some point it starts to increase. Okay. That would mean at some point the algorithm recognizes there is not a really initially gives the points that the humans are at very good. They are assigned by the algorithm to humans as you would like. Okay. And that is why the error is decreasing, but eventually when there's no any more points in which the humans are good at, the error starts to increase. So these plots basically are kind of hinting at the possibility that the algorithm is actually working. It's recognizing, oh, these points are the ones the human are good at, and they are the ones I assign first to humans. That is what you would like. Okay, after this, no, it's like to say, oh, we solve the problem now for rich regression, but I mean, there are many other tasks to start with. So for example, you could say, oh, can we do something about classification? Okay, can we take some algorithm that is kind of known and can we adapt it to this setting of having a triage? No? And the way I'm saying it, maybe you can already guess, oh, yes, we can. So a bit idea, no, like we took a convex margin-based classifiers, and in particular here you're using some version of an SVM, a support vector machine. And a bit idea now is a bit similar to the case of rich regression, no? That you would say the original formulation of this SVM would contain only some objective function that would be the first term. But again, here we do the same thing, no? That is to say, oh, there will be some set that is assigned to the machine and some set that is assigned to the humans. And here the key observation now is, if you remember, I was saying, oh, we have to compare, for example, in the rich regression, quadratic error of the humans with quadratic error of the machine, because rich regression uses the quadratic error. But here in this particular version of the SVM, the machine is using the hinge laws to try to say, oh, how much errors is doing. So here the key point is that you should also judge the human predictions in the same way, using a hinge laws. So that when you compare losses, they are kind of comparable. Okay. But a bit idea is kind of similar to the previous approach. No, we will try first to actually, oh, for a given set S, can you actually compute the optimal machine? And after to see, oh, and can we afterwards reduce the problem to a combinatorial problem and proceed from there? No, but in this case, I'm not going to give you all the details, but a bit. The main idea is to say, in this particular case of SVM, given a set S, we cannot compute analytically the W star, that would be the parameters, and the V star, that is the parameters of the SVM, but we can compute it solving a convex program. Okay, and that is something that we can compute actually fast. So a bit the idea is, if you give me a set of points you want to assign to the human, and conversely to machine, then I can tell you the best SVM. And if you plug back that SVM into the problem, we can again reduce the problem to this kind of combinatorial problem, that is only to try to find the best set S for our optimal SVMs. Okay? And in this case, no, rather than proving properties of one single function, is that we can show that the resulting objective, we can express it as a difference of two functions, okay? That they are set functions. And it turns out, again, that one of these functions satisfies one of these approximate notions of submodularity, and the other function is just a modular function, just a kind of additive. So what it means is that there is also some algorithm in the literature that other researchers introduced that have theoretical guarantees, has these approximation guarantees at solving the problem. Okay? But if you see in both cases, for rich regression and SVMs, kind of we try to do the same thing, but was quite elaborated in the sense that when you have this, you reduce it to this combinatorial problem, then proving these properties of approximate submodularity is very specific of the problem. So what we were facing is to say, oh, sure, we solved the problem for these specific cases, but it's not something that we can generalize easily to some other things that maybe people are using more in practice. So here, oh, we solved the problem, yes, but we solved it only for rich regression and SVMs. No? And if you go around giving talks about this and so on, I guess the first question that we are getting is, oh, but everybody's using deep learning now. So sure, this what you just saw is quite nice as a curiosity or something, but it's not something applicable. So that is what encouraged us to say, oh, can we do actually something that people could easily use, okay? To try to say, oh, when you have triage, you want to outsource or let's say give some points to a human, and you want to give some points to a neural network, how do you do it? No? So what I would tell you, I would like to tell you about is something that is a, let's say, work in progress, or let's say it's not completely, I mean, we have some preprint in archive, let's say, but it's not yet published. And a bit idea is that we want to also build to do something that you could tell, oh, you use SGD, stochastic gradient descent, to train you a neural net. This is the way easily that you should change SGD in a way that doesn't increase complexity, so that in the end you can actually train a model that is optimized to classify together with a human, okay, dividing the task. And a bit idea is that this, as everything in deep learning currently, like, oh, the method doesn't have like global convergence guarantees, but we will show that the method actually has local guarantees. Okay, and we will explain. And somehow the method is based on some insights that can be in retrospect quite easy, but that is like about thinking about the problem more generally. Okay, that is what I would like to tell you a little bit about. So let's come back to the same thing of saying, trying to formulate like generically learning under triage. No? So generically, what I'm thinking about is to say, you have here some expectation that would be the expectation over the data distribution. No? That you could say there is a feature distribution X, there is a label distribution Y, and there is a distribution of predictions of humans, H. Okay? So that is kind of general. And what you would like to do is to say, well, I want to minimize the expected loss of saying picking the machine for a point X. If it turns out the triage policy says pick that point, so this would be zero. That would mean, oh, if it is zero, the model predicts the sample X. Okay. So if it turns out the model predicts the sample X, you would take the loss of the machine. If it turns out the point you actually the triage policy tells you, oh, this is a should be assigned to a human, then you would take the loss of the human. No, that H is the predictions of the humans, that again would be something that comes from humans themselves. So here the problem of learning and that triage would be, we want to have the triage policy for each point X in the data distribution, and we want to find the best machine model M. Okay. Remember before in the previous part we were saying, oh, if you set the set S, we can solve the problem for rich regression, the best rich regression model of the best SVM, if we know the set S. So now we are going to start with that exactly. If we know the triage policy pi, what would be a, or let's say we are going to reverse it. We are going to say, okay, if you fix a model M, like the machine model is fixed M, what is the best triage policy? That is a bit different. Before we were starting from the triage policy, we were saying, give me the set S, and I tell you the best model. Now, give me a model. Can you tell what is the optimal thing to assign to machines or to humans? That seems something, in retrospect now, you will see that is trivial. But it's worth looking at, I mean, looking into detail, no? So here a bit the idea is that what can be proven quite easily is to say, well, if you give me a model M, the best thing to do is to say you are going to compare the error of the model and the error of the humans for every sample X. And here I put it for visualization, also like a simple case that is just one single feature X. Okay. And here what is visualized here is just the error, difference of errors between the machine, the model M, and the humans for each of these points of X. And then what the optimal triage policy is just a threshold rule that depends on the budget also. That would say, oh, you compare the two errors for a point X, and if it turns out it's greater than a threshold, you assign it to the human. If it is lower than the threshold, you assign it to the model. No, that is what this visualizes. This is the triage policy that would tell you, oh, for all this region where the model is worse than the human, I would assign it to the human. And otherwise, I would assign it to the model. Okay. So in a way, it's kind of trivial. It's, the only thing that he's saying is you compute the expected value of the loss for each point under the machine, under the human, to compare them, and you go from there. But this is also an optimal thing to do when you have a budget in how many samples you can outsource or you can give to humans. So what this budget is going to change is the threshold. Okay, if you cannot give to humans many points, then the threshold would be much more conservative, would be higher, so that the humans say receive less points. So now one other observation, no, is the following: that to say, imagine that you have the optimal predictive model for the entire distribution of data. You know, it's like this model is the best one I can find for the data I have. So if you would have that, then you would know that will happen that this model, the gradient of the loss, the expected gradient in the whole data distribution will be zero. Okay, it's just this is also fulfilled by a local optimal. Okay, but for the global optimal, it's also fulfilled. And here is one insight. No, here is the thing: if you take this this model, okay, and given this optimal model, that is the model that you show all the points, you can always compute the optimal triage policy for this model. That would be my optimal model for the whole data. Maybe it's still for some points bad. If you compute this triage policy, as we said in the previous slide, and it turns out that for all those points that the triage policy decides to give it to the machine, if the average expected gradient for those points is different than zero, then you know this optimal model for the whole dataset is suboptimal for this partition of the data as given by the optimal triage policy. So, and this can be proven formally to say, oh, there is a machine model, there is a predictive model, that if you are going to use this triage policy, then it's better than the one that you started with. And that is kind of the key idea to say, oh, how do we develop our algorithm? No, that here the idea would be, oh, the algorithm is going to be as follows. Initially, you compute with your SGD, with whatever you want, given the whole data set. You just say, oh, I assign everything to the model. And you train a predictive model that is the best you can do with SGD. Okay? So once you have that, you could say, well, now, given this model, I'm going to find the difference in error between the loss of my model in the dataset and the loss of the humans. And given that, you can compute the optimal triage policy that, let's say, to make it easy, is what I just visualized there as a toy thing, what you see here. No, that you would say, here on the top, turns out the human is better because the machine model is inaccurate, so you would give it to the humans, the rest to the models. Okay. But now that we have this triage policy, a bit idea is that at each iteration, we would proceed as follows. Okay, given the data that is, let's say, in this triage policy, this data that is the part that you assign to the model, you retrain a machine model that is just using that part of the data. Okay? So, and you know for sure that this machine model you just trained for this triage policy would be better. Okay? And then you proceed again, you find the optimal triage policy for this new model. And you proceed in steps. And it turns out that if you do that, you can actually show that the optimal triage policy you are finding and the models you are finding in a sequence over time, they keep improving. Okay? So what it means that actually an implementation of this algorithm using Monte Carlo estimates for the losses and so on, given samples, converges to a local minimum of the empirical loss. Okay? That means if you would do this, then you would be improving over time. The pairs of triage policy machine models are better and better and better. You don't know that they are going to converge to the optimal, but in practice, we will see later that they work quite well. But again, here that has some kind of problem, no? During training, we can do this because the triage policy depends on the losses, but we can evaluate these losses because we have the labels during training. But then at this time, we have a problem, no? That the triage value for each unseen sample, we don't know it because we don't know the human loss, we don't know the model loss, because we don't know the true label is what we try to predict. No? So what we do is that once we finish this whole procedure of finding better and better triage policies and machine models, at the end of the process, we actually train a parameterized triage policy that approximates this optimal triage policy we found at the end of this sequence of updates. Okay, so that now during test, you give me a point X, and then this approximate triage policy can tell whether I assign it to a machine or I assign it to the human. Here now, in the previous work that we were using this rich regression and SVMs, we use actually medical dataset that I guess is kind of the purpose of the workshop. But the problem of those medical datasets is that we have only like single annotations per patient, like a single human per sample. That is why we ended up like simulating the human error. But for this work, we wanted to say, oh, we want to have several human predictions per instance so that we can actually take the human error estimated from data, not something that we simulate. And unfortunately, there are very few of them, and the medical ones are not public, so we couldn't really use them. But we found two data sets that were public, that is about trying to detect hate speech, where you have annotations of tweets by different humans, and another one that is about classifying galaxies in some kind of a scientific discovery application, where we have tons of human predictions per image, no, like more than 30 even. In one case, it's a binary task, the one of the galaxies. The other one is a multi-class. Okay? And here is to give you some intuitions. No? So if we look at one of these data sets, no? And what you see here is for different steps of this algorithm that goes sequentially. What is in the x-axis is the average human loss per sample here. And what you see in the y-axis is the average machine loss per sample. And a bit idea now is that at the beginning of the algorithm, when you have the full automation machine model, predictive model, turns out that here what you assign to machines or what you assign to humans, according to the optimal triage policy, you see that the machine error is kind of concentrated around here. But there is not like a huge difference between the error of the points assigned to the machine eventually or the errors, the points assigned to the human. But as you go forward into the algorithm, turns out like the machine, basically whatever you assign to the machine that is here, learns to very accurately predict it. So that is why this starts to go lower. The blue points start to be lower, like lower machine error. But the points that you actually assign to humans, the machine just give up, like the error keeps increasing. Okay? And we found that at least in these two data sets, the same phenomena happen. That this is what you would expect intuitively. That is, as the machine models get to be more specialized in some part of the feature space, they start to be lower and lower error, but the error on points that they don't have to classify, because the triage policy tells them not to, the error keeps increasing. Okay? So in a way, even though the algorithm at the end has only local guarantees, seems to be moving into the right direction. And a bit the idea I also know is that we were also interested in knowing, oh, but the triage policy that we learned, the approximated one that we used during test, does it really approximate well the optimal triage policy? And here is some evidence that seems to be working in the way we want. What you see here, no, is the ratio between the machine loss and the human loss, okay? And a bit the idea is to say, if this ratio is greater than one, would mean you would like to outsource that to a human. If it is lower than one, you would have to assign it to the machine. No, it's what the optimal policy would do. And turns out that that is what actually happened in the approximate triage policy. Here, for different levels of maximum triage or budget, has that, for the points that are actually assigned eventually to the that they are assigned to the human, the ratio is lower, as you would expect. And the ones that they are assigned to the machine, the threshold is higher. And the idea is that as you allow more and more points to be assigned to the humans, the machine learns to specialize more and more in the few points that the machine is instructed to classify. Okay? And here, no, I guess in a talk, it's quite difficult to assess, what about other methods that they are in the literature? No? And there are not many, but a big idea is that there's a few that they allow this kind of deep learning models. And a bit idea is that by doing what we are doing, we are able to somehow achieve a better misclassification, or let's say lower misclassification probability during test than all the other methods in both data sets. And a bit to wrap up so that after if there are questions, they don't jump into, I don't know, lunchtime and everybody start to get hungry, no? I would like to wrap up a little bit. So a bit the idea now is that where do we go from here? So here what I talk about was all the time about this kind of supervised learning task that you would say you have labels and you have features and you try to divide the feature space between machines and humans. But you could think of many other domains where the task is more like a sequential decision-making problem. And one kind of prominent example that I guess in Germany, given the autonomous industry is kind of the driving industry is kind of quite prominent, is the case of semi-autonomous driving, that you would like to say, oh, you have a Tesla and there is this automated driving mode, but sometimes gives control to the human or not, and many times it's like at the root of some accidents that the human thought, oh, never has to take control. So in these settings that is like mixed driving, is a setting where you would have a triage policy that decides where you give control to the human on the machine, and at the same time you have to train these machine learning algorithms to be able to drive in some states. But can we design this in a similar fashion, saying that the machine learns to specialize in some states is very good at, but then in some states that makes bad actions, then you forward to a human. A second aspect that I think is also kind of important is that in this version of the problem we addressed was this kind of thing of all or nothing, no? You give it to the machine or you give it to the human. But you could imagine many situations in which you would say the human is always in control, but can receive some kind of predictive knowledge from the machine, so that takes a better decision. And it's quite challenging to think, oh, in which way this information should be conveyed to the human. No, because it's not so easy to say, oh, the human makes some prediction without a model. Now, if it has a model that provides a prediction, what would you instruct to the human to use this prediction? No, so that is not something trivial. And I guess, especially in the case of, for example, sequential decision making, would be important to validate all these algorithms using actually interventional experiments. Because, for example, if you have a car that is giving you back control from some automated mode, maybe your behavior is different than if you would be driving all the time. And this you cannot really model it faithfully, but rather you would have to do an interventional experiment to see, oh, what is the effect of this triage policy and this switching in the behavior of the human while the human is driving. Okay? And I mean, if you want to know more about any of these projects, we have it, the first two were published in AAAI, but they are also in archive, and we have also code. The last work, the one more about deep learning, is in archive, and we have also code that is very easy to use and includes the data sets that we use. And with this, I would be happy to try to answer any question you may have. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Manuel. Very interesting. Any questions, any comments? Maybe we'll put down the slides and turn on the videos. Any questions?
Maybe I start. So first of all, great presentation. I really enjoyed it. And I think it tackles very important challenges. So also in the context of how to identify what kind of data points need to be labeled, how to reduce labeling effort, and so on. So when we have these issues in our naive settings, we usually perform unsupervised learning first. So we analyze the data and see what are archetypes in the data, what kind of patterns do we see in the data, and then we make from that the decisions what kind of data we would like to have labeled. And so are you also considering these approaches, or did I just miss it somewhere?
Is related, and this whole area of saying, oh, even active learning or this thing of experimental design is very related. But I mean, we try to there is a bit of a difference, no? In the sense that in this case, your data set, let's say, all points are labeled. But it's not that you want to say, oh, which points will be difficult. You know, the motivation, at least from what I understood in your question, is to say maybe quite difficult to label data, and you want to be quite decide, oh, which of the points is more like valuable to label. No, in this case, rather it's to say like during a, it's a bit different. It's like you have all the labels, but there are maybe some of these points that are very difficult for a machine to actually classify accurately. And in this decision, you have to also take into account whether the humans would be instead being able to do better. So it's related, but it's a bit different. No, in the in our case, it's all it's a bit different motivation, but it's related. I'm happy if you drop me an email offline to point you at specifically where we compare in the papers with the setting you are referring.
Okay, thanks.
Good. Any additional questions, comments? Yes, we have. Let me just make you. Okay, now I think Nagaran, now you can unmute yourself and ask a question.
Thank you very much, Manuel, for the very nice presentation and a very detailed description on the trial algorithm triage. Usually, the problem with the what machine understand and what human can interrupt from the machine. Yeah. Still, there is one question which I would like to be in track with you is what happens if a machine is fed with low sample of data? You know, the problem of data balancing, which is always a challenge irrespective of how fast edge technology we are using. So how this approach can help us with such data unbalanced versions for let the machine learns it or the human tell him to learn it or human impact on the learning, but still the data balancing is a challenge and how it can be helpful there.
I guess in a way, I mean, it's not something that we demonstrated, but for example, if you think of unbalanced labels to say, oh, there is a set of labels that are overrepresented and the other ones not. You could imagine that maybe if by redirecting points to humans, some of those, you would improve how balanced is the data set, then the machine would be like an easier task. Or let's say it happens sometimes that when you have very unbalanced data sets, that then the best thing for the machine is like to just predict one class, no, the majority class. And if you want to avoid that, you have to either balance the data set or either do things of weighting differently each error. If you would instead say, oh, you are going to just assign some of these points to humans and decide to do that, in a way you would be balancing the data set, but not so artificially as saying, oh, first you resample to make it balanced. But it's not something we explore, but it's something that I could imagine in the first, my naive answer to that would be, oh, that may help.
Okay. Thanks for the outcome, because I work in the field of healthcare and to be very surprised, like getting a non-controlled data, the normal data is always a challenge than an unhealthy or the abnormal data, and then putting it into the balanced model is risky. But I understand the way it has to be manipulated somehow with the under samples or over the samples or some way. Yeah. Maybe I will have a read on the draft papers which you have sent, uploaded, and then maybe I will shoot out a mail on what
sure.
About this. Yeah,
perfect. Great.
Thank you so much, Manuel. Thank you.
Thanks.
Very good. Any additional questions, comments? If there are no more questions, then thank you, Manuel. Very interesting
Thanks.
Presentation. Thank you all for the good discussion. Thank you for joining. So this was the last presentation in this session. We will continue with the second session in 3 hours. So in Germany, that's 3 o'clock, 3 hours from now. I'm looking forward to seeing all of you again. Thank you and have a nice lunch break. Thank you. Bye-bye.